12 tribes of Israel returned to Judah. Isaiah chapter 43 verse 1. But now, thus said the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, who formed you, O Israel? Fear not, for I will redeem you. I have singled you out by name. You are mine. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your folk from the east, will gather you out of the west. I will say to the north, give back, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Isaiah chapter 43, verses 5 and 6. Thus said the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. For your sake I send to Babylon. I will bring down all her bars, and the Chaldeans shall raise their voice in lamentation. I am your Holy One, the Lord, your King, the Creator of Israel. That's Isaiah chapter 43, verses 14 and 15. I am about to do something new. Even now it shall come to pass. Suddenly, you shall perceive it. I will make a road through the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 19. It is I who, for my own sake, wipe your transgressions away and remember your sins no more. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 25. So the God of Israel roused the spirit of King Pul of Assyria, the spirit of King Tilgath-Pilneser of Assyria, and he carried them away, namely the Reubenites, the Gadites, and the half tribe of Manasseh, and brought them to Halah, Habor, Harah, and the river Gozan to this day. That's 1 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 26. In the days of King Pekah of Israel, King Tilgath-Pileser of Assyria came and captured Jan, Abelbeth, Makkah, Jonah, Kadesh, Hazor, Gilead, Galilee, the entire region of Naphtali, and deported all of the inhabitants to Assyria. That's 2 Kings, chapter 15, verse 29. In the ninth year of King Hoshi, the king of Assyria captured Samaria. He deported the Israelites to Assyria and settled them in Hala, at the river Habor, at the river Gozan, and in the towns of Medea. That's 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 6. The king of Assyria brought people from Babylon, Kutah, Abba, and Hamath, and Sepharvaim, and he settled them in the towns of Samaria in place of the Israelites. They took possession of Samaria and dwelt in its towns. 2 Kings chapter 17, verses 24 through 35. The king of Babylon had them struck down and put to death at Riblah in the region of Hamath. Thus, Judah was exiled from its land. Samaria is the northern kingdom, also known as Israel. That's 2 Kings chapter 25, verse 1. And also known as Ephraim. Thus said King Cyrus of Persia, the Lord God of heaven has given me all of the kingdoms of the earth and has charged me with building a house in Jerusalem. Charged him with building the second temple and gave him the kingdoms of the earth. Building him a house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. any one of you of all his people, the Lord his God be with him and let him go up. That's 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse 2. The first who settled in their towns on their property were Israelites, priests, Levites, and temple servants, while some of the Judahites and some of the Benjamites and some of the Ephraimites and some of the Manassites settled in Jerusalem. That's 1 Chronicles chapter 9, verses 2 and 3. From the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, the following verses were written by men who were eyewitnesses of the return of all of the tribes of Israel under the declaration of Cyrus of Persia, whom God anointed a Moshiach, a Gentile Moshiach, a Gentile anointed one, to clear the way for them to build the second temple. They testify that all 12 tribes and the tribe of the Levites, it's usually referred to Israel's 12 tribes. There's 13 sons, okay, but only 12 received allotted lands. The Levites did not. They could go to all the different tribal lands. So, but there's really 13 tribes, the Levites, the priestly tribe. They testified that all 12 tribes and the tribe of the Levites returned to the lands of Judah and the lands of Benjamin. The lands of the kingdom of Samaria were inhabited by imported Gentiles. That's what all that was I was reading before. That's the defeat of the northern kingdom and the importation of Gentiles. When the seventh month arrived, this is Ezra chapter 3, verse 1. When the seventh month arrived, the Israelites being settled in their towns in Judah, everybody who came back, remnants of all 13 tribes, defeated the northern kingdom by Assyria and the southern kingdom Judah by Babylon, who had was always at war with the Chaldeans. Babylon went back and forth. And that's why there's a reference in that prophecy of going to Babylon and the Chaldeans shall raise the lamentations. They even lived amongst each other. I mean, you could call them the Chaldean exiles, but basically I refer to them as Assyrian Babylonian exiles. For that matter, you could say Chaldeans, Assyrian, Chaldean, Babylon, Persian exiles, because it was Persia when they were finally allowed to leave. And my understanding is not all left. Just those that wanted to. And they were sent to Jerusalem. But there was nobody in the towns of Judah, for the most part. And the remnants of each of the tribes had to select their own property. How they did it, Scripture doesn't tell us. But we know they settled in their own towns. And that would be including, there was a mention of, carry forward. So, with that backdrop, Ezra. When the seventh month arrived, the Israelites being settled in their towns, the entire people assembled as one man in Jerusalem. Israelites. Okay, it is said and it's taught in Judaism. And I don't know where it began. It's in the Talmud. But it, in all likelihood, began before that, before the Talmud. It's a story that made it into the Talmud, I should say. I've only got two theories of why, because it's so wrong. This is the Israelites. This isn't naming two tribes that settled in the towns of Judah and Benjamin. This is the Israelites. And they gather as one man. They gathered as one man before this at Oreb. And as one man, they agreed to be the chosen people of God and abide all of the teachings of Moses given to him by God of his laws and commandments and rules. gathered, assembled as one man. That's where the whole concept of naming the matriarch Jacob. I mean, in some ways, you think they named Abraham, but named Abraham Israel, but they didn't. It was Jacob. They would, God would. The priest. Now, what follows is a series of quotes just like that, talking about Israelites. And you saw the mention that Manasseh and Ephraim returned. Those are the two largest lot owners. Ephraim, the whole North Kingdom was called the Kingdom of Ephraim at one time. And the half-tribe of Manasseh was there with the other half-tribe, the one mentioned with Gadites and, can't remember the other name. They were east, and they got carried off early. And as a matter of fact, the land of Gad is the land of Gilead. That's where Ramoth-Gilead is, and where Elijah the Tishbite, of which there's no clan of that name in the Hebrew Bible, is an inhabitant. And you know, he just appears out of nowhere, chapter 17 of either 1 or 2 Kings, and to tell, I think it's King Ahaz, it's not Ahab, that there should be no more rain. God tells him to. That's the first we've seen. He just does it. We don't know, you know, he's just Elijah Tishbite, an inhabitant of Ramoth-Gilead. Well, he's a Gentile. And we don't know if he went through a fire of refinement, but we do know from other scripture that God wrote that I can interpret because of what God has taught me, and which I've already shared in other videos, but I'm sure we'll go back over it again. But there's no question he's a man in divine beings, which is a man that the Spirit of God, like Ezekiel, enters into, and he can hear God speak. God is in his spirit. So this is what follows. The priests, the Levites, and some of the people, and the singers, gatekeepers, and the temple servants took up residence in their town, and all Israel in their towns. And in the time of Zerubbabel, and in the time of Nehemiah, and all Israel contributed the daily portions of the singers and the gatekeepers, and made sacred contributions for the Levites, and the Levites made sacred contributions for the Aaronites. It's Nehemiah verse 12, chapter 12, verse 47. Again, they're saying all of the Israelites. Everybody had to make this contribution. And I weighed out to them the silver, the gold, and the vessels, the contribution to the house of our God, which the king, his counselors and officers, and all Israel who were present had made. That would be for building the second temple. Guard them diligently. And notice also when God gave Cyrus all the kingdoms of the earth and instructed him to build his temple in Jerusalem, that he made a road for them, and that's how he did it. He had Cyrus issue that declaration, and he said to all of his people who want to go back, he didn't say you two tribes that are left over, those that couldn't find the Mediterranean and track back to the promised land, those people. When this was over, the officer approached me, saying, the people of Israel and the priests and Levites have not separated themselves from the peoples of the land whose abhorrent practices are like those of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, the Egyptians, and the Amorites. That's all the people who are still there. You know, the tribes almost to for every lot. they never completely cleared their lots of the people who were there. Either that or the practices of all these peoples, all these tribes were still there. I don't know the practices. So Ezra at once put the officers of the priests and the Levites and all Israel under oath to act accordingly, and they took the oath. All Israel. Let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to receive the prayer of your servant that I am praying to you now, day and night, on behalf of the Israelites, your servants, confessing the sins that we Israelites have committed against you, sins that I and my father's house have committed. That's Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 6. I think I got one more from Nehemiah, then I have some commentary. When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite servant heard, it displeased him greatly that someone had come intent on improving the condition of the Israelites. Nehemiah chapter 2 verse 10. The whole community that returned from the captivity made booths and dwelt in the booths. The Israelites had not done so from the days of Joshua son of Nun to that day. And there was very great rejoicing. The Israelites had not been in booths since. Now all the Israelites were doing it again. Not two tribes. The Israelites. The people Israel. As one. There's another one at chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. Okay, recapping all of that. The tribes of Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, and the northern kingdom of Samaria, were deported northwest of Babylon. You know, the river Gozan, Habath, and all this. It's northwest of Babylon, which is Iraq. And to the towns of Medea, that's Iran. And the kingdom of Judah was deported to Babylon, which is also Iraq. Jerusalem is within the lands of Benjamin, which lands are considered part of the kingdom of Judah, since that is where the kings of Judah ruled from. That is why there is an emphasis on the Judahites and Benjamites in the accounts of the return of the remnant of the 12 tribes of Israel to the lands of Judah and Benjamin. Sometimes I think that that's what happened. That since everybody went to Judah and Benjamin, it is assumed that it's the tribes of Benjamin and the tribes of Judah, and where the other ones we don't know, they got lost. That would seem to be the source of the story. And one other place is with King David. After Saul was, when he died in war, I believe he fell on his own sword eventually, but 10 of the tribes wanted David to rule in Samaria and or the kingdom of Israel. And but two tribes wanted, I don't even think they actually say which 10 and which 2, but he goes to Judah to rule. So there's another place where you got 10 and 2, but again, there's 13 sons. The Levites could vote on a king. I mean, they just didn't have a lot of land. It's the 13 tribes. Okay, the northern kingdom of Israel is inhabited. Now, this is what he dictated to me. The northern kingdom of Israel was inhabited by imported Gentiles. All of Israel had returned together to Jerusalem and Judah, mindful of all the imported Gentiles in the kingdom of Israel. Many of whom tried to stop the building of the second temple. When the seventh month arrived, the Israelites okay, I've covered that. Okay, it is said in writings by sages and rabbis that 10 of the 12 tribes of Israel became lost and did not return to Judah to build a second temple. There never were lost tribes according to the Hebrew Bible. If there were lost tribes, then Isaiah wrote a prophecy of God that was false and was not fulfilled. I'll read it again. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your folk from the east, will gather you out of the west. I will say to the north, give back, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Isaiah chapter 43, verses 5 and 6. Isaiah's prophecy is to all Assyrian Babylon exiles, returning by the words of God. The return of the exiles to the land of Israel, given to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob by covenant, and partitioned among the 12 tribes of Israel by Moses and Joshua. That is not just the Babylon exiles of Judah and Benjamin. It includes all of the tribes that were defeated, deported, and exiled by the Assyrians before them. And they came back. As I mentioned, not all of them, but those God called them. He made a prophecy. He appointed somebody to release them that had them in exile. I don't know. I mean, I guess that means they weren't allowed to leave and in a sense were slaves. I've never seen that term used. But that's what that particular prophecy is about. I know there's an in-gathering prophecy, but it's going to be the same. It's you know, all of us who want to come back. And as I've mentioned, my very presence with God with me, for those that believe, it's going to bring plenty of people back to Israel. But you're always going to have people, particularly here in America, that just grew up here. It's all they know. And they have no plans on leaving their jobs and their the places that they grew up and live and go to Israel. It's just not going to happen like so many of these things that, you know, that are in the Bible. You really got to think about them. And make them, you know, bring it into reality. There's 10 lost tribes. Really? Well, where's your big account on that? The only account you're going to find on that is in the Talmud from stories. So this other thing I think happens. Again, God doesn't explain everything to me. It's the human experience, but he gives me plenty of knowledge. Here's the other thing is that... I'll get to that later. The Babylon exiles were the last to be deported to the vast lands of Babylonia, which was once Assyria, where all the exiles were, and by this time scattered far and wide throughout Babylonia along many different rivers. Oh, this one. Actually, that finishes it up, but I guess I just said that. But this is how he dictated to me. The Babylon exiles are all 13 tribes in Assyria and Babylonia. I had to learn all this before we ever put anything on paper. And that's why sometimes I tend to just take off as I remember it. But I like to read from it because this is scripture. It's not canonized, but it's divinely given to me. Not by inspiration, as the New Testament is said to have been written by the Holy Spirit. In men, I guess. I don't know what they're talking about. I mean, I know the Holy Spirit is right here. He said, I've never been with a Christian. He said, I don't go to Christians when they accept Jesus. He said, I don't have anything to do with it. He says a little bit more, but it's kind of on the lines of God talking about it, so you probably don't want to hear that from an angel. God's not happy with this group that says he killed his son so they could disobey him. Not happy at all. He's not happy that someone says he accepts Jesus, human sacrifice. Oh, that he performs human sacrifice. Now, you might want to go learn up on the deities of the Mayans. People, I was surprised. You know, they were still around in the 1600s. The Spaniards put an end to that culture and society, which is, you know, again, it's something for people like Jews for Judaism to know. You're still here. You who have been put upon so much that it became your duty to atone for the world so that God would take his imperfect creation and make it perfect for you. And you would be exalted and held up high, and acknowledge that you've been right about God all along. All Christians will see that Jesus is a false idol. And all Muslims, that's 4 billion people, that their gods are false. That there's only one true God, the God of Israel. What I will tell the Christians, there's only one true teacher of righteousness. There's only one true man described in Isaiah 53, and you're listening to him. I'm a man in divine beings. That's the important part. But you have a description of me. I have a book that explains everything that happened to me in my life that helps fit those verses, or that evidences I fit the verses. And I'm the only man who's ever been able to explain it. I'm the only man who's ever shown the connection between Ezekiel and that. And an intelligent man I am, but I'm not smarter than every Jew who's ever lived that studied this and commentated on it and put it together. They've lived on this book for 3,000 years, or for whenever the first scroll was written by Moses. David's about 3,000 years ago, and however many generations there were between David and the partition of the lots in those tribes. I know there's 400 years in Egypt. So at some point you have to say it's simply not possible. And if it's not possible, there's only one answer. It is God. It is a miracle that I know these things. And for that matter, it is a miracle I'm alive. Period. I offer myself for guilt. I received long life. I was told I had about a month or so to live 20 years ago, and I'm not seeing a doctor since. Not only that, I showed no signs of lung cancer. I survived colon cancer that I had no business surviving. It was so advanced by the time I got treatment. So I had that one other thing on attending too, I thought. Okay, that's all I had. I do have a short clip I wanted to put on of my, it came up this morning because I was reading, they told me to do this particular video and from the book, and it says Cyrus received the kingdoms of all the world from God. And he was appointed to build the second temple. While I'm declaring the way for the third temple and so many other things I got to do. What am I giving a motorcycle? Then I love it. And I still got all kinds of spare price. Because I'd go to your fire refinery for free. If I didn't have a single fun thing to do. If I wasn't going to go to Israel, if I wasn't going to be the speaker I always wanted to be as a lawyer, but just simply didn't measure up, I'd still go through it just to be the changed person that I am and to get to know him in his spirit, the great, great persons. Anyway, a brief...
All right, this video is right here is for those naysayers that think that an Indian scout is a slouch. That's Amy right there. That's all I got. I can tell you one thing, this bike loves.